The title of my sermon this morning is The Cross, Getting Unstuck. Have any of you ever had your vehicle stuck? Most of y'all? I'm going to assume most of you have had a vehicle stuck in the mud, in the sand, in something really bad, right? You get that weird feeling at first where you feel like you really don't have control of the wheel anymore, and you're pressing on the accelerator, and you're not going near as fast as you know it should be when you have your lead foot on the accelerator. And so, what do? You start throttling the gas, right? Throttling the gas or whatever you happen to do. Maybe you slam on the gas, but you're turning the wheel. You're doing anything and everything you can. And as the more you start to not move, the harder you're going, because you're getting panicky, right? Because you're getting stuck. And if you keep going, what happens? You go all the way down until somebody has to use a tractor or something to get you out. I hate the feeling of feeling stuck. And by the time you get out, you say to yourself, I'm not going to make that mistake again. I'm not going to drive right back into the sand again or whatever it happens to get stuck in. But in my hometown, there was a great excitement, huge excitement, lit up faces when it really began to pour in my little hometown of Thorndale. My classmates would get really excited because what they knew is that after school, they were going to take all their large 4x4 jacked up trucks and Jeeps out to any low spot in the area so they could go mudding. That's what they lived for. And so they'd take all their trucks down to this really low spot. And there was one just a couple of miles from my house, and they would bring tractors and everything else out. And so they would they would just go sliding all over the place. And every once in a while, they get super stuck, right? But there's a tractor, and the tractor would come pull them unstuck. Guess what they would do? They would go around, they'd check, they'd make sure there's no damage to the vehicle, and they'd drive right back into the mud. And that's fun, that's entertainment, right? Nothing wrong with that, except for a whole lot of people live most of their life like that. They get a few moments of getting unstuck out of something. They feel they've been stuck, and they say, Jesus, I need you to come get my life unstuck. And the church, somebody in their life helps them get back unstuck. And what do? They drive right back into the mud. They either get themselves stuck, maybe life sticks to them, as they say. But now here's the thing. You could be rich. You could be successful. And as the world sees it, you're going to be looking great. But you can still have all that stuff and be spiritually, emotionally, and relationally stuck. And what you're going to do is you're going to have those places in your life that are stuck. So when you're throttling, you're trying some other area of life, wealth, whatever it happens to be, to try to figure out a way to get your life unstuck, to get out of where you're feeling like you're just not feeling fulfilled. You're not living an abundant life. Now, many people like to treat God like that tractor I was talking about. They think to call on him when they get stuck, and again, right back in the mud. And Paul realizes in Romans chapter 6 that Christians are using this same kind of logic. They imagine grace and the cross are covering their sins, and so they're unstuck. And they never get stuck again because they have all this grace that God has. And so they can go and sin all they want. That's actually the argument that they're making. We mock that logic. We go, man, that's really silly. Jesus died so I don't have sin. If sin is gone, therefore I can do anything I want. That's the logic that Paul's talking about in Romans 6. And we might go, well, of course, that's silly. But we live it all the time. You know, we know that Jesus didn't die so that we could relish in the mud, in our sinful and messed up desires, our twisted thinking. Now, Jesus' desire for you is to get out of the proverbial mud and start living down the path God designed for you. The cross of Jesus is the death to the sin-loving life. Now, it's a choice you decide you want to make. What I want to talk about this morning is how the cross helps us understand and live this new life. But I want to look at Romans chapter 6, and we're going to be looking at it from this angle. There's several verses that talk about being new or what it's like to live this new life. But I think Romans 6, 5 through 14 is so powerful. And this is what he's saying after he's told them that's messed up logic. He says this, "For if we have become united with him," which is Jesus, "in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died is free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again, death no longer is master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not be master over you, for you are not under law, but under grace." What I realize when I'm reading this, especially in verse 11, is that the cross is both judgment and grace. It's kind of a weird statement. I almost put those separate, right? But many of us want to see the cross simply in this one sense of grace and forgiveness. But the cross implies much more. I would say not less, but much more. Verse 11 says that we must consider ourselves dead to sin. This means that you must accept that the cross, it was the proper judgment you should have received. The cross was the proper judgment. The cross judges the world. It judges our methods. It judges our motivations and our aims. There are serious repercussions in your everyday life as a Christian if you imagine the cross as a place of grace without also understanding it as a place of judgment. Without judgment, there is nothing new that was ever needed. Without him saying, this was broken, there's not a need for the grace side of that coin. There is not a God who was working to set things right if there is not judgment. We're stuck in how we are. We're stuck in the mud if there isn't a judgment of what is wrong with going on inside of us, in our society, in our families, in our community, in our churches. There would simply be an unending cycle of pain and misery until we die. That's where we get the mottos on bumper stickers that I probably shouldn't mention. The cross is the manifestation of our failure in the highest sense. And you almost have to come to this realization before you can even start talking about God's grace for your life. The cross is our biggest moment as humanity of failure. We read Paul recently who said in 1 Corinthians, if they had known true wisdom, if they had known who Jesus really was, they would have had the vision to see, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. We're all fools, is what Paul's saying. In Romans, Paul says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's a realization that you got to come to. And I tell you what, if you're feeling stuck, it might be a pretty good realization to go and admit, yeah, I am stuck. He said I was stuck and I'm stuck. What are you going to do about it? And then get the answer of the cross, right? But there is a great place in the judgment of the cross simply of its timing. Have you ever thought about this? Just the fact that there's the grace that judgment happened then. Because what's basic is everybody knew in the Jewish world that there was a judgment at the end that was coming. But what God did is he came and he brought judgment in the middle of time. And when he brought that judgment in the middle of time, we could see in the life and the cross and the resurrection of Jesus that we were truly heading the wrong direction. And that final judgment was not going to be good for any of us. And so even that grace of bringing judgment, which is headed only for the end time, into the middle of time, is an amazing grace in and of itself. You know, he sent his son just to reveal himself in this way. I would call it not with a judgment that brought condemnation, but realization. Opening, unblinding, a light. We, Jews and Gentiles, condemned him, and God called him righteous. We are so distorted as to kill the utterly innocent. Now, you have to understand, it's not just the Jews and the Romans at that time who would have done such things. It is all of us. It is a condemnation for how we think, for how we're motivated, for how we think we get to power, for how we think we get what we want. For trying ourselves to get ourselves unstuck is to hurt somebody else to get our way. This should shock our thinking on a daily basis, even as Christians, because we still suffer with sin. We still suffer with the old world. We still have things that pull us and make us distorted in our thinking. And so every time, not just as when coming to Christ, but every time that we find ourselves stuck, there's an initial place that we have to go, and that's back to the cross type of thinking. Back to the cross where God has revealed himself in his son. And I won't just say the cross, but Jesus and his whole life as epitomized on the cross. Now, verse 11 still, that is where it talks about, that's where life is at. Life eternal, yes, again, but it is a present life. Sometimes when we read that he gives you life in the Bible, we always want to put it off to heaven or whenever, at the end. He's talking about you can have and start experiencing life in the present. That's growing you and forming you into the whole and genuine person he created you to be. And when you miss out on the divine judgment of the cross, you don't understand that you need to go in prayer and say, God, I need your judgment and grace in my life. I need those two coins. I need those things in my life. Because I don't want to wait until I die to know life. I want life now, here in the present. I want unstuck from the different things that I feel stuck in. I think no one gets this better than the end of Psalm 139, which I read earlier. After pleading his case to get unstuck from enemies and from anger, and he has a moment of worshiping God, but he says that he will accept God's judgment. I'll read it again. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts. And see if there is any hurtful way within me, and lead me in the everlasting way. Get me unstuck. I want a path, not right back into the mud. I want to go somewhere. I'm not waiting to heaven till I get to go somewhere. I want to go somewhere where I feel the rich warmth, knowledge that God's wisdom is working in my life. The writer even accepts there may be problems in himself that he cannot see. So sometimes you're stuck and you're like, I think I'm doing everything right. What do? You have to go back to the cross. You have to go back in prayer and in dialogue with God, which means listening to him as much as you are talking to him and accepting what he has to say. And that was going to require Bible study. What does he say about all these things? And start reflecting. Does my life reflect what Jesus is expecting? All right, now, are any of y'all in a rut? I don't want you to say it in your head. I don't want you to feel like you need to raise your hand. I want you to say something like maybe in your head, yes, I am, or you know what, I'm in a pretty good place. Be honest. If you're in a great place, wonderful. But be honest, if you're in a rut right now, admit that to yourself. Maybe there's patterns in your life that's your fate, that's your destiny or whatever, it's your personality. Maybe everything looks like everyone else's fault, I don't know. But if you want unstuck from the pit, then you need to call upon the cross of God and come before it. Humble yourselves. Accept that you need that judgment. But you can try to find all kinds of ways to look for Christian abundance and the life that he promises through service. You can look and try to do a bunch of churchy things. You're just going to get stuck and burned out if you're not coming before the Lord and finding His grace and finding Him sufficient. It's not until you completely understand that Christ has taken your cross for you that you can find anything meaningful in taking up your cross and following Him. I want to say that again. I think it's very important. You cannot feel fulfilled, right? You have to completely understand that Christ has taken your cross, what you had coming, for you to find anything meaningful in taking up your cross and serving Him, following Him, applying the rules. You have to understand how much He loves you, how much He gave up for you, how much His judgment was your judgment, and now you can trust His judgment of you. Do you accept God's judgment in your life? That's a hard thing. We don't like that word. Nobody likes that word. But getting unstuck requires God's love and justice. So judgment and love are often pitted against each other in our world. What's the world's favorite Bible verse? Well, that's Christians' favorite Bible verse. What's the world's favorite Bible verse to quote back to us? Do not judge. That's it. Do not judge. Oh, how many times have I heard that just by opening my mouth about anything? Do not judge. The Bible uses the word judgment, though, in many different ways. And in some ways, we are to practice judgment in our lives. And in other ways, we are called not to, but it's forbidden for us to practice judgment. I'll call one of them discernment and correction, and the other one is condemnation or even acquittal. Now, both belong to God. Both are His rightful domain. But only one of them belongs to us to practice as well. And it's actually a little bit more of another topic, so we won't go very far into it. But the kind of judgment we must practice is cross-shaped judgment, while the type that we are refused to practice is the judgment seat of God kind of condemnation that we are not allowed to practice, that we are not allowed to destroy others. We are not allowed to assume and make sure that we understand you're not going to heaven and you are. One of the biggest mistakes I've ever made in my ministry is assuming everybody in the room is going to heaven. And therefore, I don't preach the word that it needs to be. That's another kind of judgment that's not proper to do. Now, cross-shaped judgment brings both discernment and grace, like they're two sides of the same coin. Judgment without grace is reserved solely for God's judgment against those who deny cross-shaped lives by the end of their life. I see a lot of confused faces. I'll say that one again. Judgment without grace is reserved solely for God's judgment against those who have denied cross-shaped lives, about living and having and accepting the grace that comes with the cross. Judgment's coming one way or another. The question is, do you accept the judgment of the cross, or will you only accept the final judgment that is condemning? Now, the two look very different in real life, too. They look very, very different in real life. Have you ever had someone tell you what was wrong with you? Oh, we don't handle that well. I don't handle that well. I don't know anybody who handles well getting told that they are wrong. Or that, here's worse, you are a whatever. That's probably not the best way to handle it either. But still, nobody likes going, you really messed up over there. If I ask you to raise your hand who likes that, some of you would be like, oh, yes, I want to grow. You don't like it. Now, you might know you need it, but you don't like it. So I don't want to hear that. I know nobody likes it. Now, if you think a person has selfish motivations or wants to hurt you, then how do you respond? You're always going to respond poorly. You're not, even if they're right, you're not going to listen to them. Right? Someone who you think does not love you, you're just going to, at best, blow them off, I hope. Now, some people take everything very seriously, but some people who see God as tyrannical decline any judgment God has made, because that's coming from a source who they think doesn't really care or love them. Now, that's kind of every time somebody says something in the Bible that's discerning or sinful, they think it's end of the world judgment. But what happens when you really believe someone loves you and they have proven it time and time again that they want what's best for your life, and they come to you and they say, you know what, I think you messed up right here. I think you're having some problems right here. You are 10 times more likely to at least consider that what they're saying to you is true. See how that's more cross-based. It's coming with love. It's coming with a desire not to destroy you, not to condemn you, but to transform you into something where you're developing. It's cross-shaped grace and judgment. So, again, that's what it means to accept that you're a sinner. Because you know why? How much more would you listen to someone who's died for you? How much more would you listen to someone who would walk in the ruts and trenches and the worst parts of your life with you? That's Jesus Christ. That's God Himself, not coming down from above and telling us, you need to live this way, but coming down into our lives and saying, you know what? You could have such more abundant life if you got rid of the sin in your life. So when you're reading the Bible, when you're coming with brothers and sisters and saints who've proven that they loved you, not every statement of judgment and discernment is a statement of condemnation, or it's not, well, only Jesus has the right to say that to me. It's not how that works. So it's important to get this straight in your head. Jesus accepted the condemnation of judgment for me. Therefore, I can trust Him. He accepted the consequences for me of the problem that I did. He accepted the consequences of the sin that's getting you stuck. And so you might ought to listen to Him going, you know what, I'd rather not go through this the next time because I love you. Now there's another group that we might be inclined to carefully listen to when they talk to us and tell us advice, and that is the expert. Now, that's why every blog on the internet is claiming to be an expert at something or everything, because they think that that is the way to get you to listen to them. It's why you go to the doctor. It's why you hire a guide to go fishing. Basic stuff. They're the expert. It's why when the doctor tells me I'm overweight, I can't do anything but nod my head. Keep my hurt feelings inside. They're the expert. Now, they're supposed to know what is good and how to arrive at that destination. Yet again, God is your creator. He is the maker and designer of who you are. There is no greater expert than Him when it comes to you. But love and expertise are both requirements for this cross-like judgment. You see, for instance, a loved one may have your best interest at heart and be a total fool. May not really understand the way the cross works. May not really have a good sense of that. They may not have good advice. And on the other hand, many people have ceased listening to experts because they seem to have some ulterior motives and motivations. We don't know. Why? Because we don't know if they really love us. So we don't know whether or not they have their own personal motivations or ulterior motivations. And so we come to this point where we know they don't love us and they disagree with us, so they must be bad. See how the logic spins, and it can keep spinning back and around and around. But Jesus on the cross is the love, the wisdom, and the power to bring judgment into your life. He's all of these combined. You cannot simply dismiss Him as saying, well, I think God and the Bible have some good advice for some folks, but it's not for me. He's your maker, creator, expert, and died for you. Now, You're tired of looking around to see how to get unstuck, to get out of the pickle. Look again. Say it again. Look to the one who loves you and knows you. Pour yourself out to him. Let him bring you out of the rut. And I talked a little about prayer a moment ago, but one simple and good measure of the humility for you to listen to God's judgment in your life is how much time you spend in reflective prayer, not just intercessory prayer where you're talking, but reflective prayer and study. Bible study, studying with others. It's a measure of how you might wonder if he is good and loving or distant and uncaring. Because if you think that God is loving and an expert on you, then guess what you want to do? You don't want to get stuck, or you want to get unstuck. You're going to find the one. You're going to go to the one who gives you life. Maybe whether he knows what he is doing or if he is the wisdom of the world, that's going to be found out whether or not you are taking time. Especially if you're spending more time on the internet looking for how to be better at yada, 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 have your best life now, and the long lists that people love. I think if God were to write in the 21st century the Bible, we would all want him to write it in a top 10 list. But he didn't. And it's not healthy. He wrote it in a narrative, and he wrote it in a way that teaches and considers so much different. He is the story. You know, here's the last thing I want to leave with you. Consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. That's what he says there at the end in the Romans chapter 6 that I read. You have been set free, that's what Paul's saying, so act free. It's not that much more complicated. You have been set free, so start acting free. You've been pulled out of the mud, quit driving back into it. Joining in Jesus' death brought an end to the bullying power of sin in your life. Yes, it's still hard. It's still difficult. But by the power of God, by his death, and by you dying in him, you have died to sin, and it no longer has power over you. Well, you know what that means? You're still choosing, most of the time, sin, rather than letting yourself die to Christ and living in him. Now, these things, when I say it's a choice, sometimes it's a choice of neglect because you're not going in prayer, you're not going and studying, you're not figuring out what it is in life where you could live abundantly. You just rather go, you know what? It's kind of easier here in the mud. But I want to let you know that this throne room, as we sit here today and say, thank you, God, I am alive. We are alive in Christ Jesus. I am not my sin any longer. It no longer has a hold on us. I am yours, Lord, you can say. How could we live again in such shame but to accept that he was right and imitate him? You know, to bring ourselves to him and die. Just think on that. Bring yourself to him and die. Grace is not there so we can get stuck again, but to help each one of us move. As David said in here, lead me in the everlasting way. There's a direction, a path, a purpose God has called you for, and you can't live that everlasting way. You can't find that path God has for your life if you're constantly stuck in the mud of sin. Bow down to him. Let him give you life. As you accept grace, you seek his judgment and guidance. You know, I was going to tell one story, and another one has come over me this morning that I really want to share. It's from John chapter 8. There was a woman, as Jesus is walking, and she has been surrounded by all these men and people, and she has been caught in adultery. And they're standing around in the circle, as I imagine it. I'm not sure it says circle, but maybe that's my imagination. Standing around with stones ready to stone her. And they say, Rabbi, look, we found her like in the action. She's totally guilty. There's no way around it. And what should we do? They want to condemn her. See that type of judgment. They want to condemn her. And he says what? You who has no sin, cast the first stone. And slowly they put the stones away. And he walks, he goes to her, and he says, "Who's condemned you?" That kind of judgment. And she says, "No one." He said, "Neither do I condemn you in that way." That's not what he was about at this time. It's not what he was doing. And he says two things. Go and sin no more. You see, he didn't ignore that she was sinning. He's not, he judges her in that grace, go and sin no more. I don't know how much weight to put in this last part, but church tradition tells us that there is a good chance that this was Mary Magdalene. And she took that opportunity of Jesus taking her out of the mud and giving her new life. And when he said, go, that one word, go, she gave all that she had to him. And today we know her name, it is believed. God is giving you a chance. Every time he says, I give you my grace, he's giving you that opportunity for a new life today and tomorrow. Not the kind of judgment that's going to condemn you or make you unvaluable or unworthy, but it's the kind of judgment God gives to make you valuable, to make you worthy, to make you be able to stand confidently before the throne of grace by his blood, but also by his work of forming us into his image. So that's my challenge to you today. Take time to immerse yourself in God's voice in your life. Remember whose you are. Remember who you follow. I know it's hard to break out of the old patterns. It's hard for me to break out of old patterns. But if there is a place where temptation is high, I want you to put a note that says, I am yours, Jesus. Because you're his and you belong to sin no longer. Accept that part of your life, whatever it takes. I want God's grace and his judgment to pierce your life and mend you. We even read in Hebrews, I think it was last week, we had the section right after it that said, the word of God is sharper and will pierce heart and soul, all the different, it'll reveal us. We need that in our lives for him to come and show us who we are, but show us what we're about. And it's time to get out of the mud and follow the path. What a beautiful opportunity when Jesus Christ says to you, go and sin no more. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer?